Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Read This If, a collection of essays that prove someone else gets it too. Edited by Thought Catalog. Narrated by Amy Landon and Graham Halstead. 1. Read This If Nobody Texted You Good Morning by Heidi Priebe. First of all, good morning, beautiful. Is it too late to say that? I know you've probably been awake a while, likely hours or even all day. I know you may have gone this whole time without hearing it, shrugging back to friends and family who asked how you're doing with the noncommittal, fine, because that is what we're meant to do as humans. Answer meaningful questions with arbitrary phrases. I know that you may not be fine. I know that you may have had a lackluster day. And I know that something as incredibly mundane as a good morning text may have made all the difference in the world. It's okay if that's the case. It's okay to sometimes ache for those simple and kind-hearted gestures. Because the truth is, the good morning texts are more than a half-hearted means of communication. They are a sign that we are thought of, cared for, adored by someone who may not be immediately present. They are a reminder, one we perhaps should not need, but sometimes do, that we are appreciated in our entireties. So if you did not get one this morning, here is what I want you to know. You deserve to have a good day today. Not because of some universal law that necessitates good things happening to worthwhile people, but because we all do. We all deserve to have a beautiful morning and a correspondingly fantastic day, regardless of who loves us or appreciates us or thinks of us first thing when they wake up in the AM. Just because someone is not around to appreciate the complexities of who you are does not mean that you deserve anything less than pure joy. And in case there's no one else to remind you, here is what else I want you to know. There's a particular way you laugh that can make an entire room light up, if only for a moment in time. There is a way you tilt your head when you are concentrating that makes you look unbearably kissable, as if you were placed on this earth only to stare at things and frown in the most endearing form humanly possible. There is a noise you make when you are falling asleep, a soft, almost inaudible sigh that sounds like the ethereal embodiment of all that is tranquil and calm. There are a thousand minute intricacies that make up the tapestry of who you are, and not a single one has ceased to exist since the last time that somebody loved you. I know we're not supposed to need reminders of that. I know that we're supposed to be strong and self-sufficient and reassured, certain of our own worth, questioning only the value of others. But we're human. We forget. We forget that we are lovable. We forget that we're desired. We forget that we are anything other than the hard-shelled, busybody workaholics that we've all been trained to behave as. We forget that we, too, merit adoration. And here's what it's easiest to forget. Who you are doesn't cease to exist because there's nobody there to admire it. The way you bite your pencil is still cute, even when there's nobody to tease you for it. The way you hold yourself still exudes confidence, even if there's no one to assert it to. The way your eyes light up when you're talking about what you love is, and endlessly will be, attractive, regardless of who is there to listen to you speak. All the little quirks that make you up are not extinguished because somebody once chose against them. You still deserve to have a good day, even when there's no one there to wish it to you, even if you forget to remind yourself. Someday someone's going to love all those tiny things about you. Someone's going to love the way you cough. They're going to laugh at the way you lose your keys while you're actually holding them. Someday, someone is going to stare at you from across a crowded room and know exactly how you're feeling, based on the way your head is tilting or the type of wine you've used to fill your glass. Someone is going to appreciate all of your obscurities eventually. But right now, they are all only your own. And that's okay. First and foremost, you will always belong to yourself. Here's what I urge of you if you did not receive a good morning text today. don't forget about what makes you incredible. Don't let your own intricacies slide, because the lovable parts of you are not gone. I absolutely promise you that much. You are so much more than the person who nobody texted this morning. You are encompassing. You are fierce. You are a blazing, roaring fire in a world full of people who've been burned. So please, refuse to let the wounded people extinguish you. Refuse to be tamed. Refuse to flicker down into a meager, burnt-out coal because somebody else is not tending to your flame. At the end of the day, we're all in charge of what we bring to our lives. So be the person who brings light to your own, even if nobody else shows up to it. Be the person who has a good day, even if nobody wishes it to them. Find a way to fuel your flame when no one else remembers to, because the world needs the light you give off. And you, my dear, are too intense a power to be reduced by something as small and insignificant as the lack of a good morning text. 2. Read this if it feels like your depression is getting the best of you. By Kendra Syrdal. Around you, the sun keeps rising and setting. The traffic keeps pressing through in the most unrelenting way. The clouds roll by. The holidays happen. Everybody talks about how they can't believe October is over and winter is almost here. And you smile behind steaming cider, as if you're just as excited as them. But really? If you were being truly honest, you'd admit that nothing has felt different since August. Rather, everything feels blurry, muffled. You've lost track of the days and the nights, because instead of being individual sunrises and sunsets, it's just another day of you feeling like you're walking upstream against a raging current. And instead of fighting, instead of it feeling like a challenge, you're just getting tired. Too many times you've just lain in bed, avoiding any and every responsibility. You don't know when the last time you checked your mail was. It's probably overflowing with unanswered letters from cable companies, thank God for automatic withdrawal, and catalogs filled with girls who had enough energy to wash their hair that morning. You sit in the tub watching the now lukewarm water draining beneath you, and you wish for a second that you'd go down with it into some abyss where there are not problems outside of wondering where the end of the pipe will take you. The stereotypical depressed person is always in the dark, maybe with ugly, forlorn, black mascara streaks painting her cheeks, or maybe with staring with his bloodshot red eyes from popping vessels while sobbing. And they sit alone, still in the dark, with that unnecessary war paint, contemplating how much better the world would be without them. And even though that's a stereotype, sometimes that monster comes in rearing its nasty head and messes everything up. As terrible as the extreme depression, the scary feeling of doom that exists more often than not, it's a different monster. And it's a monster that doesn't exist in the crazy highs or lows. And because of that, it isn't as easy to spot. It hangs out in the corners undetected, just waiting until it can latch on and never let go. Depression sometimes is a feeling of utter desolation. But what about when it isn't? Sarah Silverman recently described depression as the feeling of homesickness, but you're home, so there's no way to satiate the feeling. I couldn't agree or relate more. It's knowing you have no real reason to not be ecstatic, to not be happy, but instead of feeling anything, all you can feel is unenthused, sulky, static. It's seeing all of the crayons laid out in front of you, the entire 120-count Crayola box you always coveted in grade school, every single color you could possibly imagine. It's seeing them and having the ability to pick any color, but only being able to force yourself back to the same broken gray crayon day after day after day. It's watching people promote asinine things like drinking more tea and running for the endorphins and thinking, fine, I'll give it a fucking shot. but then your bladder is bursting from your 18th cup of stupid chamomile, and your shins are aching from running for hours. But even after heeding all of this naturopathic bullshit, you still just want to sit on the kitchen floor and eventually blend into your surroundings, ceasing to be you, because being you is getting exhausting. It's hearing about how Prozac changed someone's life and how therapy is their everything. So you keep popping open the little orange bottle and talking about your ex-best friend and your fears every Thursday. You do all of the things you're supposed to do, but nothing's different. It's researching at 4 a.m. for any possible answer, but still not wanting to smile at jokes on Twitter or text anyone back because you just suck. And if you know it, they must know it too. It's feeling like the same bland, sad, murky version of yourself day after day, and just wondering if this is how the rest of your life will be. So even though you got up this morning, and you felt like nothing was different, you feel like you've accepted that you will never have highs again. You still feel like you're looking through fogged-up glasses, and you're simply going through the motions. There's one thing to keep in mind. You did get up. And even though your world right now is that broken gray, your vision is clouded, your homesickness has not been relieved, and you're choking down more fucking tea to try and naturally cure yourself, one day, it won't feel that way. It might not be tomorrow or next month, but eventually, it will be one day. That day, your eyes will be clear, your heart won't be heavy, and you'll find yourself reaching for an orange or a green while you order a coffee, because why not? You just have to keep getting up. 3. Read this if you're 23 and lost, by Heidi Priebe. So you're 23 and you have no idea what comes next. First of all, congratulations. You're ahead of the game. Do you know how long most people wait to realize that they're lost? Do you know how many people never do? Do you understand how many people go through their entire lives aimlessly floundering, only to realize at the very end of it that none of what they did was what they wanted? It's a lot more than you'd think. And most of those people thought they had it all figured out at 23. After all, it's not so hard to be found when you were 23 years old. There are infinite hordes of people who will tell you what to do and where to go. There are endless opportunities for you to make money and prosper. All you have to do is let go of what you want for yourself. You just have to subscribe to living someone else's dream. If you are lost at 23, you are exactly where you need to be right now. I know that it is not where you would like, stuck in the middle of uncertainty and failure and your own inconsistent desires. I know it's not the place you thought you'd be when you screamed, "Cheers!" on your 20th birthday in anticipation of the next exciting decade. I know that you would rather be just about anywhere but here, except you can't figure out where to go and it is driving you slowly up the wall. I know what it's like to be 23 and lost. I know that it's the worst place on earth. But the fact that you are lost right now tells you something. It tells you that your life as it has been is not your life as it will be. It tells you that you're not the kind of person who settles for okay or sort of good enough. The fact that you are lost tells you that you would rather be living in the middle of uncertainty than dead set on something that makes you consistently miserable. And I'm not sure if you realize how rare that really is. How few people still give a shit about doing something meaningful with their lives. How many more people we need who are just like you, lost and reeling, yet still pushing themselves to do better. You are lost because you care. You're lost because you're passionate. You're lost because you know that there is more inside of you than what you're currently offering the world, and that is a brilliant thing to know. At 23, J.K. Rowling was broke. Tina Fey was working at the YMCA. Oprah had just gotten fired from her first job as a TV reporter, and Walt Disney had declared bankruptcy. None of these wildly successful individuals could have predicted what was in store for them next, but the one thing they all had in common was that they knew that there was more to them than what they were doing at the time. And that's what you have in common with them too. You know that there's a bigger, better version of yourself to bring to life. You just haven't gotten there yet. So, let's look at where to go from here. If your life is lying splintered on the floor, which pieces do you want to pick up and keep? Which do you leave? What do you choose not to recreate now that you're given the chance to start over? Because that is exactly the chance that you have at 23. You get to strip your life down to its bare bones and build the whole thing back up from scratch. It's not the easiest thing to do, but it's the best thing, the bravest thing, the most rewarding thing, and the kind of thing you only get the opportunity to do through being lost. So right now, let yourself be a little bit lost, because you don't get found by staying comfortable. You don't get found by running away. You don't get found by fighting your deepest impulses, and you definitely don't get found by hiding out. You get found by doing exactly what it is that you are doing right now, which is delving right into the heart of your life and fighting like hell for what matters. If you're never lost, you never get found. And you're the kind of person worth searching for. 4. Read This If You've Stopped Believing in Love, by Heidi Priebe. Love doesn't start off difficult to believe in. The first, even the second time you love someone, you're starry-eyed and open-hearted. You rush into relationships with the unshakable eagerness of a toddler trying their first solid food. You've been starved for real love all of your life, and suddenly there it is, available to you in abundance. So you give and you take and you want and you demand so much from those first few relationships. You want the love story you have been waiting for. You want the partner you truly deserve. You have a laundry list of everything you cannot wait to do, see, experience, and become through loving someone else. You have so much to give. You have so much to receive. If your expectations fail to be met, you just pretend and invent. Your first love story takes place largely inside your own mind, and in many ways, you're fine with that. Even the falling apart of the relationship possesses a certain poetic tragedy. The good things cannot last forever, and you know that. And so, you try again. You fall in love again. You hope again. You feel again. You have faith again that this one is going to be it for real. And you repeat this process as many times as it takes. Until somewhere along the line, something goes wrong. Something inside of you breaks in the place where it is always only bent. And in a swift, unexpected instant, your heart falls cleanly apart. The truth about these kinds of heartbreaks is that they don't bring the raw form of pain that you're used to. It's not the excruciating hurt, mind-numbing disbelief, or short-lived anger that you're used to going through at the end of a relationship. It isn't a fiery, passionate emotion that you can empower yourself back from the brink of. It's something much quieter and subtler. It's the acceptance of the idea, from some deep place within you, that maybe love isn't what you thought it was. That if you can fight that hard for that long with someone you care about that much and still have it all fall to pieces, maybe there isn't much left out there to hope for. Maybe love doesn't really conquer anything. Maybe it's all just some grandiose idea we made up to sell jewelry and distract ourselves from the painful realities of living. Maybe none of it was ever built to last.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.